Welcome to State of the Arts in Illinois, a podcast by the Marion Cultural Institute. Our guest today is Tabitha Tripp, a Southern Illinois artist. Tabitha and I discuss her artistic background, her journey as an artist, and her most recent series that will be displayed here at the Marion Cultural and Civic Center through September and October. Tabitha, thank you for joining us today.
Well, thanks for having me.
So you are from the Southern Illinois region. Where are you about? Where about are you from in Southern Illinois?
I live outside of Anna.
How long have you been there?
I have lived in Anna nearly my entire life.
So growing up in Anna, what led you to become an artist?
You want the cheesy story?
As real as it can get.
I always wanted to be an artist. My grandmother was very supportive of growing up to be whatever we wanted to be, which is kind of strange considering she's very German in her heritage. But she said, you can grow up to be an artist if you want to be that. And so she supported it. She always had crayons. She always had tracing paper. She always had art supplies for me to play with when I went over. And so I decided, now that I'm 50 this year, that I should actually make good on that.
So you knew from a very young age, do you remember the moment or general time period when you realized that that's exactly what you wanted to do?
I think the real turning point for me was I was doing a lot of independent classes after school at night. There was a drawing and painting class that I went to that my parents helped support. But the turning point for me was when I got a scholarship to go to Savannah College of Art and Design.
That sounds like a big turning point.
It was. It was huge because I was like, where does this school come from? And it was a private school, and they had seen a pointillism black and white pen and ink drawing that I did, and that's what won me the scholarship. Now, it wasn't a huge scholarship by any means, but it did tell me that, hey, people are looking at me, and they think I'm good enough to go to this private school. It only lasted a year because we couldn't afford it. And so I came back here to Southern Illinois to finish off at Johnny Logan and Carbondale.
Savannah College of Art and Design is an incredibly prestigious art school. And it's such an honor just to be able to attend there. How did they find that piece that led them to where they recognized you?
I believe there was a competition that the teacher sent our artwork off to, and they were picking from people from that competition. I think it was maybe at Springfield, but I don't recall the details.
So your art teacher in high school,
mm-hmm,
is the one that submitted?
Yep.
So you were pretty serious about art in high school as well?
Oh, yeah.
So this all started whenever you were young and your grandmother saw that you had a love for art, mm-hmm, and started to support you. And then you pursued that once you were in junior high and high school, and you were able to focus more on certain classes. You were able to focus more on your art then.
Yeah.
So what would you say you gained the most from Savannah College of Art and Design?
Oh, their core classes were phenomenal. They, their 2D and 3D programs really hammered in the principles of art, your concepts. And then color theory. I struggled through these classes. These 2D, 3D, and color theory were so difficult. The teacher's expectations were so high. But when I came back here and started taking classes at John A. and SIU, I was like, holy cow, I learned everything that I need to know to get through the next 6 years. I took the long track. But their expectations of their students, I think, just pushed us up to that next level where I don't think I would have got that here locally.
It's amazing when people have high expectations, how as humans, we rise to what's expected.
It is. Yes.
And being able to experience that through Savannah College of Art and Design, and then coming back to John A. Logan and SIU and applying what you had already been through and the expectations that were there for you with them, did that set you up to kind of be ahead of the curve with within your classes and within your peers once you were in that place?
That's a really good question. I think what I lacked was being humble. You know, coming back home, I think I was a little bit bitter, not being able to finish off at SCAD. But I do think it changed the way that I looked at my classes, in particular the painting classes and the drawing classes. I think the thing that was frustrating mostly for me is, like, in high school, I was just a, you know, average student, C's and B's. At Savannah College, I was straight A's. I excelled and I was on the honor program. And then when I came back to SIU, I felt like I still struggled because the class sizes were bigger. The core curriculum that you had to take, the general ed classes, kind of brought my GPA down. So I think that was difficult. But I also feel like I said, those core classes, 2D, 3D, and color theory really, really hammered in the groundwork that I needed to kind of get me actually to where I am here.
So you mentioned that you came into your painting classes with a different outlook whenever you came back to Southern Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
What was that different outlook that you came into those classes with?
I was frustrated that I had to move back here.
Yeah.
It was frustrating because I also tried to switch my major. I went from being, Savannah College was mostly two-dimensional. When I came back to SIU, I wanted to explore pottery. My dad was really big into ceramics. I thought I wanted to be a ceramicist. And then that didn't work out. I'm not going to go into details about that. But I switched my major to zoology. And then I realized how much I really liked two-dimensional work. So Michael Onken took me back into a BFA program. And I finished with a fine arts degree in painting.
That's an interesting track.
I'm really big into zoological, biological sciences. And that kind of fits in to my family's upbringing. My dad was really big into the sciences as well, but also had a knick for artistic ability.
So it sounds like you had a lot of support from every aspect of your family, coming up into the arts and in having a father that was into ceramics. It sounds like there was a real atmosphere of respect for the arts throughout your upbringing.
Definitely was, yeah. My dad designed and built their home, our home that I grew up in. There was lots of artistic expression in that. I think that one of the things he's passed, he was always frustrated with his paintings too. So he would have much rather been woodworking or sculpting or pottery. But my parents, and my mom is still terribly supportive. She's my biggest collector. Surprise, surprise.
So it's amazing. You know, there's a stereotype around small town and rural. The idea of the focus in those communities is so much towards athletics and business but I don't find that to be true, really. I find that to be a false stereotype that, while it might not be a big, broad, general support in every community for the arts, it really is up to individual household and core groups that you find yourself within as to where you find that support, and that support fosters an artistic mindset moving forward. So you came out of SIU, having studied pottery or ceramics, zoology, and then painting mm-hmm. eventually. I'm intrigued by the zoology part of it. Do you feel like that ever had any influence on your artwork down the road? The time that you spent as a zoology student?
That's a good question. I don't think it did.
Okay.
I think it was really, I think it was the way that I just looked at the world. I think maybe the art had more impact on the zoology.
Interesting. So there's a lot to being an artist. There's a lot to finding your own voice as an artist. At any point, did you find yourself in a position where you felt like you'd really finally found your voice and your focus as an artist?
Oh, I think that's an ever evolving thing for an artist. I think that there's always the next art series or the next art piece that you find more of your voice. I think it's a constant uncovering of one's voice.
So you think the voice is more of a representation of yourself at the time of the work?
Definitely.
Rather than a general overarching broad statement of self?
I feel like I'm relatively young and immature as an artist, that I won't be able to answer that question until maybe 25 years from now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
get back to me.
You mentioned that... that you're just now fulfilling that role of pursuing arts full time.
Mm-hmm.
What was the time from graduating with a degree in painting till now?
Well, there was two marriages. There were children. There was building a house. There was environmental activism and advocacy. And then the death of my father. And that is what propelled me into saying that life is too short and it's shorter than we think. So I need to really focus on the thing that I always wanted to be when I grew up, and that is an artist.
And so that was 25 years essentially to find yourself as an artist once again.
Mm-hmm.
How did you then just jump back in to being an artist at that point, or jump back into the art form itself?
Well, I never completely dropped it. There was always, when I built our house with my husband and my father, there was always the designated studio space. It was always that room that was designed into the house. That was where it was going to be. That was what was going to happen. So there was always art in my life. And I think that kind of took the place over the 25 years that I was able to have time that I would find to make a little bit of art here and there. I've done a couple exhibits over that 25 years, solo shows at Cristado's. There was a couple other places I can't remember off the top of my head, but I didn't let it fall completely out of reach. I thought if that happened, that would be the death of it, and I didn't want that part of me to die. That would not be good. So I just slowly kept little pieces going here and there.
So it was always present. It just wasn't a primary focus of your life.
It wasn't front burner.
Okay. And so after your father's passing, it became front burner because you were ready to jump in and dive and just pursue it as your passion at that point.
Yep.
Was there anything that shifted for you from an artistic standpoint whenever you finally made that leap?
I think the things that shifted most for me in the last 3 years have been from realistic landscapes to more abstract concepts. So I've been doing landscapes and flowers most of my life. And so I was ready to make a change and say, well, you know what? I've seen the world. I've seen a lot of the world, not all of the world, but I want to start exploring what it is that my internal self starts to see from the things I have taken in and experienced through the things that have happened in my life.
So it's pretty straightforward whenever you approach a landscape or a floral piece that this is what you're painting and that's what's going onto the canvas.
Mm-hmm.
But whenever you're approaching an abstract, how do you even start?
I just start playing. To be quite honest, most of this is just me exploring, every day. Like, there's a different feeling. There's a different mood that's happening internally. And I think over the last definitely 18 months, I've had to figure out ways, the consistency in the feeling that's happening. Getting to the studio every day, creating the schedule of working in the studio every day, not getting sidetracked by, something that's happening in the house or whatever, the garden needs to be picked. Just getting in the studio every day and creating how I'm feeling. And it kind of started from a lot of anger, a lot of frustration, a lot of angst about the environmental aspects that were happening in the world, in particular climate change, that we seem to be going over that climate cliff of catastrophe, and weather is becoming increasingly chaotic. And it's like, I was very frustrated. And so a lot of my paintings about 18 months ago, you could see the frustration. And so now I'm trying to step back a little bit and find some solace, find some soothing, find, expression with texture rather than these really angry brush strokes. So it's just been me exploring emotion without being in your face about what the emotion is.
So it's 100% an emotional process for you whenever you're approaching an abstract.
I would say majority emotional and experimentation. What does this texture do? What does this color do over top of that texture? What does this transparent glaze do? What is that? How do the layers work? How do you create an interesting composition not using landscape or flowers? Because I love flowers. I love Georgia O'Keeffe, and I really enjoy the Catskill River painters. It's just there. How do you create interesting artwork that isn't something that people can relate to in a world that's quickly disappearing?
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned George O'Keeffe. In your abstract paintings, where do you feel like what other artists do you feel like your style comes from? Is there anything that is present in your current work that you can connect to the influence of another artist or their style?
I can't. Most of the artists I've been following were from the Cold Wax Academy, Jerry McLaughlin and Rebecca Krall. Probably never heard of them. They do cold wax. And that's what I've really been getting into is cold wax and oil. And I went down to Mexico in March and I attended a workshop that number one in San Miguel, Mexico was just amazing, beautiful landscape. But now I can see the influence on the San Miguel landscape and their artwork. And I was like, oh, now I get it. It's not completely abstract to me anymore. It's not just shapes and colors. And so I've been trying to study how those abstract paintings work and what works for me, what I find visually intriguing and inviting in each of those pieces. And then there's a couple other Instagram artists that I've been following that I'm just enamored with, what they're doing with the texture and the line and the shapes. So I think we're over inundated with artists these days. And so there's not any one particular one that I can holler about except the Cold Wax Academy.
So I like what you said about being inundated with artists, because literally everything that we experience these days, there's been an artist's touch in it. People look at social media, or they look at the news, they look at any one of these things, and every aspect of any of those things has been crafted by an artist at some point.
Mm-hmm.
The interface itself and the curvature of the frames that you're typing within were created by a graphic artist at one point. If you're watching the news, the set was created by an artist. The slides that are coming up on the screen are created by a graphic artist. And so everything that we interact, especially with our phones and everything that's so present, we're constantly encountering imagery that was created by someone.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are surrounded by art more now than we ever have been.
Yep.
Within that, how do you find your place as an artist?
Oh, it is hard. I was just listening to an artist podcast on the way up about confidence as an artist. And I think sometimes if I let that stuff get to me too much, I'm like, oh, I'm not, this is crap. This, you know, and pretty soon I've got a stack of, you know, things I don't appreciate. So I have to like step back and not overindulge, but also like, why is it, ask myself very, very critical question. What is it about that piece that I do like? What is it about this piece that's really off-putting to me? Like there's some stuff out there that's really bad. And it's like, well, why is it bad? Why do I not like it? But why does this person think it's so great that they're selling it for $500? You know, and like try to figure out what it is that's triggering me or, you know, off-putting so that I still stay in a place of learning from what I am seeing.
And that's another great point is that just because we're inundated with art doesn't mean we're inundated with good art.
It could be really bad.
And that all of that is all so subjective, top to bottom.
Terribly.
To where what one person encounters and views as good art, others don't have appreciation for. And it really all falls down to your own personal taste within art. Now, granted, there are fundamentals and basics of line and color theory and composition. But even within that, those fundamentals don't necessarily translate to public appreciation.
No.
And whether something is technically sound and good by all of the fundamental metrics, the public response to it can be completely different whether those things are present or not.
Yeah.
I'm just wrapping my mind around, there are so many things within the art world that it's the way that it affects others' emotions or mental state. So, you know, as you're creating your art, it's your emotions, it's your psyche being put out there.
Mm-hmm.
But then what you have put out there and what people take from it are two completely different things. And once it leaves your studio or your mind or, you know, goes from your screen out to the internet, however it's distributed, your emotional curation of that piece no longer is yours and it goes out and it's whatever the curation of emotion that happens from that piece to the people taking in the art,
mm-hmm.
To what they receive.
Right.
Do you ever get frustrated by that? That,
yes.
That what you see it from and where it comes from for you is taken completely different directions from that point forward.
I hung a show down at the Anna Art Center and I had all of my abstract, and then I actually had two pieces from previous, like before I went to Mexico, and everything else was after Mexico. And one woman's like, she's like, this is the only one I like. And she points to the landscape, a very small landscape. In my opinion, it wasn't great. It was okay. Otherwise, I wouldn't put it up, right? But I was really surprised at how judgmental. She didn't even want to look at the abstract. She didn't want to even, like, read the statement that went with the MMIP project I did. And I was just like, wow. She just completely shut down at the landscape. And for me, it was like, you don't want to see, like, the landscape for me are superficial. They're very consumer driven. Like, I make landscapes because people do like them, and they're better received. But I want to express a deeper issue. I want to express something that's happening to an Indigenous friend, and I want you to understand it from my point of view, or I want you to at least consider what it's like from my point of view to hear these stories. And she didn't want to even like entertain that. And so it was frustrating for me. Like, I just was like, forget it. It's not worth my time. But even my other abstract pieces, like, this is how I'm perceiving the world right now. This is how I'm perceiving our environment. And like, maybe stop to consider it with me. I think one of the things that I do miss most about school or workshops or whatever, where there's other artists, is the critique. I value the critique of artistic minds in a way that we can break down the abstract or the realist paintings and like to actually help each other to create better artwork.
You mentioned the landscape versus the abstracts. And it came across that the abstracts are so much more pure expression than the landscapes. And so I it's hard not to take it personally when anyone critiques your work.
Yeah.
Especially when your work is your experience and your voice. So let's talk about this series.
All right.
And you mentioned your Indigenous friend, and that this series is an expression of that in some way. Talk us through this series and what that standpoint is.
So I have a friend that's struggling with cancer up in Winnipeg, and they are Indigenous, and some of their experiences are mind-blowing and harrowing. They live through the boarding school issues. I don't know if you know about the colonizing of Indigenous youth. Basically, the Canadian government and some U.S. government agencies remove children from Indigenous households in order to make them better citizens of America and Canada, and de-Indian them. Basically take their culture away from them so that they would no longer remember their Indigenous culture and heritage, language, hair, religious ceremonies, traditional medicines, all of that stuff was basically whitewashed from their memory. And I know they took children so young that they couldn't remember who their families were. Well, my friend was part of that experience. They were sexually assaulted in the boarding school. They had trouble. I say she and they because this person is a two-spirit. And in Indigenous culture, two-spirit means somebody that doesn't identify with male or female. They identify with both. And that's a sacred spirit in the Indigenous community. And so Cedar lived through that experience, but lost touch with their original family and had to seek out their brother and their family members after the fact, but is now struggling with cancer. And this person, Cedar, has also lost several of their friends and family members to people being taken away, at, not only to their boarding school, but also in human trafficking, which is when you live near extraction communities, and Cedar lives near the tar sands up in Canada, people are stolen. Indigenous people are stolen at a much higher rate than white people. And they go missing. So it's the Missing and Murdered Indigenous Peoples Project. And proceeds from the pieces that sell will go back to support Cedar in their cancer. It's a pretty deep conversation. The the abstract pieces that I've been working on started with a large piece for the Women's Voices exhibit in Carbondale that Teresa has fixed put together. And I started with a very large piece with a cold wax painting on canvas and some cutout canvas dresses applied to the canvas, and then shears put over that with a matriarch dressed in a Northwestern, a Canadian Northwestern tribal shawl. And that one has led to another 13 now paintings. The red in each one of the paintings symbolizes a missing and murdered Indigenous person that has gone missing. And when a community loses a loved one to being stolen, and they don't know what happened to the person, they usually hang a red dress outside. And so you would see these red dresses in this this is a really intense conversation. So what had happened? I'll just back up a little bit. What had happened was that there was a pipeline that was going through an Indigenous community up in Canada, and the Indigenous community stopped and they put a blockade, basically, a lot like Standing Rock, except they had already built a lodge. They had built a sweat lodge. They had built houses. They had built medicine rooms. And they had started to build a community to hope to stop this pipeline. And the images that came from that pipeline fight were really, really strong for me. Like, they've stuck with me. And it's the matriarch that's standing there in her Northwestern shawl, and the red dresses in the snow. And those red dresses just, like, hanging there. Like, just, like, you could tell they were somebody's loved one and they're just missing their physical form. And for me, that was so moving. And I wasn't there. But it's impacted me. And the stories that Cedar would tell me about another sister went missing, another Two-Spirit person went missing, another Two-Spirit sister, you know. And, like, Cedar was constantly letting me know another person went missing and nobody gave two about it.
And this was all from one community.
This was all from one person's network. Like, how can you lose that many Indigenous people? How many people have to go missing before we have to, like, you know, why isn't it important enough that they're not being found? I remember 2 years ago, there was a white woman who went across the country with her boyfriend, and the news was all about it when she went missing. But we don't talk about the thousands of missing and murdered Indigenous people that have gone missing, let alone the children that are buried under all those boarding schools I talked about earlier that are still being uncovered.
And so this series is a way for you to start to put a voice to that in your way.
Yeah.
And a lot of these abstracts are your emotional response to that.
Yes.
So we can see the red represented, which represents those red dresses, which is each a different person missing from that Indigenous community. What else can we see in this series of paintings that is representative that we can connect to like that?
That's it. I don't know what else you'll see in them. I think that one of the other things I really have enjoyed is the layers, like so many layers. I have started to use line work in some of the paintings. And I think for me, the thing, I feel like there's always a line connecting me to you. There's always those degrees of separation, but I don't feel like there's so many degrees of separation anymore. There's literally a heartstring here to you, right? And there's a heartstring to Cedar, and there's a heartstring to another missing person. And so, like, I think the thing that is intriguing to me is the layers and the strings.
So the linear nature of aspects of these paintings is a way that you are directly connected to the people viewing it and the people that are represented within these paintings and the void that is created when these people have been taken from the communities that's represented in these paintings.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing their stories. And thank you for being transparent with your emotions with us. And sharing that, because these are stories that need to be told. And there needs to be a representation of these. And so we appreciate you voicing that with us today. I really look forward to the series hanging here in the Marion Cultural and Civic Center. It's going to just be displayed here for the next 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And some of this will be explained in text that accompanies the artwork as well.
Yeah.
And so we welcome anyone listening to come to the Marion Cultural and Civic Center and see these. Is there representation of these images online anywhere that people could experience, see them, if they're not able to make it here?
I've started to put them up on my website, which is tabithatripp.art.
Okay.
That's two P's.
All right. And so we'll put that link in the description of the videos, as well as the description of the episode on the podcasts, so that people can find that as well.
That'd be great.
Thank you for spending some time with us today, Tabitha. It's been a pleasure speaking with you, and we appreciate the work that you're doing.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us for State of the Art Southern Illinois, a podcast by the Marion Cultural and Civic Center, featuring local artists, artisans, musicians, arts organizations, and arts events in Southern Illinois, as well as touring artists coming to the Marion Cultural and Civic Center. Special thanks to Tabitha Tripp for her time speaking with us today. And a special thank you to Wingtips for providing this episode's soundtrack. Join us every Thursday morning for a new episode on Facebook, YouTube, or whatever audio podcast service you prefer. And now for Cross the Line by Wingtips in its entirety. You came in close, but I stood guard. Now don't get it twisted, I trust in your words. It's just that I have been here, and there's too much I've learned. Too many others come and gone, cause I use both sides. Too many people thought they could get by telling. Cross the line, just look both ways.